Good morning, students. Welcome back to another lecture of the signals and system. In the previous classes, we have studied the Fourier transform necessity, and by making use of Fourier transform, we can convert the time domain signal into the frequency domain signal, and by making use of the Fourier transform, periodic signals and the aperiodic signals can be analyzed. So here the point is noted that Fourier transform can be applied for the periodic signals and the aperiodic signals, and when the signal is in the time domain, analysis of that particular signal is somewhat difficult. And if you convert that time domain signal into the frequency domain signal, analysis of that particular signal is far better compared to the when the signal is in the time domain. So here, Fourier transform we have been using as a mathematical tool, which is used to convert the time domain signal into the frequency domain signal, where the signal can be easily and effectively analyzed. Now I'm going to talk about the existence of the Fourier transform. That means to which signals the Fourier transform can be applied. What is the limitation of that Fourier transform? So this existence of Fourier transform is also named as Dirichlet conditions. That means the Fourier transform does not exist for all aperiodic functions. Even though the Fourier transform can be used for analysis of aperiodic signals, but the Fourier transform does not exist for all aperiodic signals or functions. It is a limitation of the Fourier transform. So we should know, even though that signal is an aperiodic signal, we should know that whether it can has the Fourier transform or not. That is nothing but existence of the Fourier transform. The conditions for a function x of t to have its Fourier transform is called the Dirichlet conditions. That means we have to go through some conditions of x of t. If x of t satisfies those conditions, we can tell that this x of t can have its Fourier transform. If x of t doesn't satisfy those conditions, then we can easily tell that this is not going to have its Fourier transform. So here the point is noted that all the aperiodic signals doesn't have its Fourier transform. The Fourier transform does not exist for all aperiodic functions. The conditions for a x of t to have its Fourier transform, that is called as Dirichlet condition. Let assume that x of t is a signal. X of t, it is a continuous time signal and it is a time domain signal. So we are saying that it is a aperiodic signal, and the point is noted that the Fourier transform does not exist for all aperiodic signals. All aperiodic signal, that means what? The Fourier transform can be existed for specific aperiodic signals only. That specific aperiodic signals has to satisfy the three conditions. These three conditions combinedly we can call it as Dirichlet conditions. Dirichlet conditions. If this x of t, we wanted to calculate the Fourier transform of x of t, if x of t satisfies these three conditions, then only it can has its Fourier transform. Then what are the three conditions? These three conditions combinedly we can call them as Dirichlet conditions. And in which the first one is we wanted to calculate the Fourier transform of a time domain signal, that is x of t. It must be absolutely integrable over the interval minus infinity to plus infinity. That means what? We wanted to calculate the Fourier transform of x of t. That must be a absolute integrable in the interval minus infinity to plus infinity, that is modulus of x of t dt must be absolute integrable. That means we require to get the finite value of integration. If it is having the finite value of integration, we can say that it is absolutely integrable over the interval minus infinity to plus infinity. If x of t is a time domain signal, we wanted to calculate the Fourier transform of that particular signal. If it is satisfies the condition, first condition, integral of that particular x of t must be less than infinity, then we can calculate its Fourier transform. As we are discussing the first condition, if it is satisfies, then we can tell that it can have its Fourier transform. It can exist its Fourier transform. First point is nothing but x of t is a time domain signal. We wanted to calculate its Fourier transform so that its integrable must be finite value within the interval minus infinity to plus infinity. The second condition in the Dirichlet condition, nothing but x of t has finite number of discontinuities in every finite time interval. Further, each of these discontinuities must be finite. That means what? We are saying x of t is a aperiodic signal. X of t is a aperiodic signal. Let assume that this is a aperiodic signal. This is a aperiodic signal. Aperiodic signal is nothing but the signal is not going to repeated again. It is not going to repeated again, in which it is absolutely integrable, and it is called as aperiodic signal. The second point is noted that x of t has finite number of discontinuities in every finite time interval. See here, here to here signal is there, but here to here there is no signal. Here to here there is no signal. That means what? It is having the finite discontinuities. Finite discontinuities. It is having the finite number of discontinuities in every finite time interval. Further, each of these discontinuities must be finite. This is the second point. Third point, x of t must have a finite number of maxima and the minimum value in every finite number of interval. So here, the third point, x of t is a aperiodic signal in which we are going with the one particular signal like this. In this finite value, in this discontinuities, we require to have the finite minimum value and finite maximum value. It is a maximum value and it is a minimum value. Three conditions it has to satisfy, then only it can has its Fourier transform. First one is x of t must be an absolute integrable, and second one, it requires to have the finite discontinuities, and the second one, in this finite discontinuity, it requires to have the minimum and the maximum value. Three conditions. If these three conditions satisfied by a time domain signal, then we can have its frequency domain signal, that is x of omega, by making use of the Fourier transform. In the last class, I have explained Fourier transform is a mathematical tool which is used to convert the time domain signal into the frequency domain. Let x of t is what? X of t is a time domain signal and it is absolutely integrable, and it is having the finite discontinuities, and it is having the, in that finite discontinuities, it is having the minimum and the maximum value. And x of t, on which we are applying the Fourier transform, after satisfying these three conditions, we are applying the Fourier transform, then we can get the signal, that is frequency domain signal, by making use of the Fourier transform. So these three conditions, we can call them as Dirichlet conditions or existence of Fourier transform, and this question will be this question is the damn sure question in the examination point of view. Explain the Dirichlet condition. Explain the Dirichlet condition for the 2 marks. You can be asked for the 2 marks. First one, first point is what? The x of t, which is to which we wanted to calculate the Fourier transform, that integration must be a finite value, and it requires to have the finite discontinuities. In this finite discontinuities, minimum and the maximum values we require to have. So this is one of the important, and the next topic in the syllabus, that is some of the important signals. That means what? In this third unit, we are going to study the Fourier transform and how the Fourier transform can be obtained, how the Fourier transform of any x of t can be obtained by making use of some various methods we are going to discuss now. And the second point is another thing we are going to study, in that after getting the Fourier transform of various signals, and we have to study the properties of Fourier transform. Anyway, I'm going to explain some more important signals. After completion of these some more important signals, we have to obtain the Fourier transform of those signals. Then in earlier classes, in the previous classes, that is in the first unit, we have studied the three basic signals. We have studied the three basic signals. First signal is named as unit step signal. First signal is unit step signal. It is denoted with u of t if it is continuous time signal. If it is u of n, that is a discrete time signal. Second signal we have discussed in the first unit itself, that is a ramp signal. Ramp signal, if it is continuous time, that is r of t. If it is a discrete time, that is r of n. And the last signal we have discussed in the first unit, that is a impulse signal. And the impulse signal, if it is a continuous time, that is del of t. And if it is discrete time, that is del of n. So we have discussed the three basic signals. Along with these three basic signals, now I'm going to talk about some more important signal, in which the first one I'm going to talk about the sync signal. Sync signal is also called as function. Signal is also called as function, so that we can say that sync signal is nothing but it is a sync function. We can call it is a sync function. Sync signal is also called as a sync function. Sync function is defined. Sync function is one of the standard function. It is denoted by the sync of t. Sync of t. T means what? It is a time domain signal, and it is a continuous time signal. Continuous time signal, and it is denoted with sync of t. That means what? This is one of the important standard function. It is denoted by sync of t, and it can be denoted with sync of t is equals to sine t by t. For all, we can have from minus infinity to plus infinity. This function is named as, it is a sync function. By applying the various values for the t value, we can easily have the sync function. And we are saying that it is a continuous time signal. Always the independent variable must be taken on x-axis, and the amplitude of the signal must be taken on y-axis, that is sync of t. This is, so it is t, and this one is a sync of t. Then substitute the zero value. Now it is what it is. So now I am substituting t is equals to 0. Sine 0 by 0. Sine 0 is 0. 0 by 0 is 1 now. Sine, I'm applying the 0 now. Now I'm applying the 0. 0 sine 0 by 0. Sine 0 is 0. Sine 0 is 0. 0 by 0 is 1. I can have the signal is like this. Then I can substitute the pi by 2 now. Then I can substitute the pi by 2. That is sine pi by 2 by pi by 2. Sine pi by 2 is nothing but it is 1. 1 by pi by 2. Then I'm substituting various values of t. In previous case, I have substituted 0. Now I'm substituting t is equals to pi by 2. If t is equals to pi by 2, sine pi by 2 is 1, and 1 by pi by 2, it is 2 into pi. That means what? It is nothing but, sorry, it is pi by 2 is nothing but, it is 2 by pi, we can get 2 by pi is nothing but, pi is 3.14, we can have the 0.63. 0.63 means what? This is 1. Now I am getting 0.63 is here. And next I can substitute t is equals to pi now. T is equals to pi means sin pi by sin pi by pi. Sin pi is what? It is 0. 0 by pi. 0 by pi is also 0. So that I can get the signal is here. That means what? This is 0 and this is pi by 2 and it is pi. Next again we can go with the 3 pi by 2. This is 0, pi by 2. This is pi, then there's a 2 pi by 2 and this is the 3 pi by 2 and it is 2 pi. Like that we can have the signal, and if you substitute all the signals, you can get the signal is sync signal. Sync signal will be like this. So this is, if you apply the same minus values for the t also, you can get the signal is sync signal will be like this. This is nothing but it is a sync signal. So one may ask the doubt is that sync signal value is 0 at n is equal, n, t is equals to n pi. At t is equals to n pi, t is equals to n pi, this sync signal value will be 0. This is 0. This is n pi. This is minus n pi and this is plus n pi. And this t value will be plus infinity to the minus infinity. This particular signal is named as, this particular signal is named as sync signal or the sync function. Sync function is one of the standard function. It is denoted by sync of t and it can be expressed sync of t is equals to sine t by t for minus infinity to plus infinite. From the minus infinity to plus infinite by substituting the various values for the t, we can have the sync signal and this is nothing but it is a sync signal. A sync signal is also very, very important as we discuss the various basic signals such as unit step signal, unit ramp signal. This is by seeing this signal, we can identify that it is a even signal. It is a even signal. Even signal condition is what? We have the signal that is x of t. If this x of t satisfies the condition, x of t is equals to x of minus t, then we can call it is a even signal. This is here this is x of t part and this is x of minus t part. X of t, whatever the signal is there at the x of t, the same signal will be there for the x of minus t, so that this particular signal is named as we can call it is a even signal. Sync signal or sync function is nothing but it is a even signal. Now I am going to talk about the one more signal here along with the unit step, unit ramp, unit step, ramp signal, impulse signal. Again we have studied the sync signal. Sync signal is denoted with sync of t, which is nothing but sine t by t for minus infinity to plus infinity. This is about the one more important signal in the signals and system. Now I am going to talk about the some more important signals. After knowing all these signals, we have to calculate the Fourier transform of those particular signals. Then I am going with the another signal that is nothing but it is the rectangular pulse signal. I am going to talk about the rectangular pulse signals. Rectangular pulse signal, it can be denoted with, pi of t by tau. Pi of t by tau, the unit rectangular pulse function is denoted with pi of t by tau. Tau is a independent variable and it is a constant. Then we are going with the this particular rectangular pulse function and it is denoted with pi of t by tau is equals to, we can write if it is unit unit pulse rectangular signal, then unit means whose value is 1 for it is having the value is 1 for example it is a rectangle function here too. Here the rectangle signal is there, that I am saying it is minus pi by 2 and this is plus pi by 2. That means what? It is having the rectangular function, it is having the rectangular function from minus pi by 2 plus pi by 2. It is minus pi by 2 plus pi by 2, in which the amplitude is 1. So that what we are saying, this is the representation of the rectangular pulse function pi of t by tau is equals to 1 for it is having the 1 amplitude, where t, this is x of this x axis represent the t, that is independent variable, and this is nothing but it is the amplitude of the signal, that is pi of t by tau. So from here to here the signal amplitude is 1, so that I can say that modulus of t is less than or is equals to tau by 2. When the t value is less than or is equals to tau by 2, whose amplitude is 1, and the remaining all the values of t whose amplitude is 0. This is the representation of the rectangular pulse function. This is otherwise whose amplitude is 0. From here to here, minus pi by 2 to plus minus tau by 2 to plus tau by 2, whose amplitude is 1, and the remaining values of t whose amplitude is 0. This is nothing but it is the rectangular pulse function. Example, if you wanted to take example, for tau is equals to 1, I am taking tau is equals to 1. In this equation, I am taking the example tau is equals to 1, then the signal will be pi of t only. It is simple, pi of t by tau is equals to 1, so that we can represent this whose amplitude is 1 for then modulus of t less than or is equals to tau is equals to 1, so that it is 1 by 2. Otherwise it is a 0, so that we can easily represent the signal. Here we have to replace what? Tau is nothing but here what? Tau is equals to 1, and so that the rectangular signal is there from minus 1 by 2 to plus 1 by 2, whose amplitude remains 1, and after the 1 by 2 and in both sides after the 1 by 2 whose amplitude is 0, and in that way you can test the rectangular pulse function. Rectangular pulse function is denoted with pi. Rectangular pulse function is denoted with pi, and in the rectangular pulse function we will be having only one amplitude. For example, here the amplitude is a, here the amplitude is a, you have to replace this by a. Likewise, you can have the rectangular function. This rectangular function is also the even function. Because the condition of the even signal, that is, if a signal that is x of t satisfies the condition, that is x of t is equals to x of minus t, then that signal is named as a even signal. Like the sinc function, this rectangular function is also the even signal, because whatever the signal is there for the t is equals to minus value, plus value, and the same signal is there for the t is equals to negative values also. In that way we can classify the signal whether that is a even signal or odd signal. This is about the representation of the rectangular pulse function. Then I'm going to talk about the another function, that is a triangular pulse function. The unit triangular pulse function is denoted with, now it is denoted with the triangle symbol, and that is nothing but del of this, you can call it is del of t by tau. We know that tau is a constant, and it is given as whose amplitude is 1. If you go with the triangular signal will be like this, whose amplitude is here high and here 0 and here 0. From here to here signal is reducing amplitude, and from here to here the signal amplitude is getting reduced, but yet this value amplitude will be high. That is, if you go for, that is a unit triangular pulse function whose amplitude is 1 at t is equals to 0. That means what? at t is equals to 0 here, I am assuming the whose amplitude is 1. And if you wanted to take this any number also, you can, if it is phi, you can write phi. If it is a, you can write a here. So now I am taking this is 1. Now this is the plus t and this is the minus t. That means what? As the t value has been, as the t value is increasing from 0 to positive side and the 0 to negative side, then the amplitude of that particular signal is going to be reduced. Amplitude of that signal is going to be reduced at one particular point. That amplitude is going to be 0. Then only we can say that it is a triangular signal. This is what? It is a triangular pulse function. It is a triangular pulse function at t is equals to 0, whose amplitude is high. As the t value is increasing from the positive 0 to positive side and the 0 to the negative side, amplitude is getting reduced. At t is equals to one particular value, that amplitude is completely 0. Let assume that t is a minus tau by 2 and here this is plus tau by 2, and this particular signal is named as a unit triangular pulse function because it is amplitude is 1 here, so that we can have it is, we can call it is unit triangular pulse function, and it is denoted with del of t by tau is equals to 1 at t is equals to 0. Otherwise, it commonly you can represent it is 1 minus 2 modulus t by tau for t modulus of t less than tau by 2. Substitute tau by 2 here. For here to here, from here to here, that represents minus tau by 2 to plus tau by 2, it is representing. And the remaining values what? Remaining values of t value will be a 0 only for otherwise. Then you can test this signal also. You can test this one, see this one. We have a signal is what? 1 minus 2 by modulus t by tau. We are saying for from t value is less than or is equals to tau by 2. That may be minus tau by 2 and plus tau. Then first substitute t is equals to 0. If t is equals to 0, this is 1 minus 2 by 0. This is t is 0 means 0 by tau means 0, and it is 0. And it is 1 minus 2 into 0. That is 1 minus 0 will be 1 only. Now we got at t is equals to 0. At t is equals to 0, whose amplitude is 1. Then substitute t is equals to t by 2. 1 minus 2 into t is equals to tau by 2. It is tau by 2. I can substitute by the tau. Tau get cancelled and 2 get cancelled. And this is 1 now. So that 1 minus 1 will be 0. Now here we got the amplitude is 0. In same case, you can apply the minus tau by 2 also. This signal is named as it is a triangular pulse function. This signal is called as triangular pulse function. And the next signal we are going to talk about. So far we have discussed the three signals. First signal is a sync function. Next signal we have discussed the rectangular pulse function. Third signal we have discussed, it is triangular pulse function. And in the first unit we have discussed about the three more signals, three more functions, such as unit step signal, unit ramp signal, and the impulse signal. And I'm going to talk about the two more signals. With these two more signals, this important basic signals will be completed. After that we are going to study the Fourier transform of these particular some important signals. After that, we have to study the Fourier transform and its properties. The remaining two signals I am going to talk in the next class, such as the Gaussian function, and next one is a signum function. Gaussian function and the signum functions also very important in the important signals, such like unit step signal, unit ramp signal, and the impulse signal, sync function, rectangular signal, and the triangular signal, along with those, and these two also very important. Anyway, I'm going to cover these two topics in the next class. If the time permit, tomorrow morning I'll share this class in the WhatsApp groups. Thank you, students, and don't waste the time, and keep on listening the video classes and try to write the notes from the video lectures for all the subjects. That will help you a lot when you are going to prepare for the external exams and the any other competitive exams. Thank you, students. Thank you so much.